spite of the past mistakes, our administration, though, we've been able to fulfill the promises that I've made to Chicago and deliver for the people of Chicago, and we did it in a fiscally responsible way. It turns out that you can invest in people. It turns out that you can invest into the core values of what makes us this incredible city and do it eloquently and do it responsibly. We invested in our city's future by increasing the number of young people hired through the One Summer Chicago program. We hired a total of almost 28,000 young people, which is nearly an 8,000 increase since I've been sworn in. And through One Summer Chicago, we were able to make sure that young people could gain professional experience and real paying jobs and a vision for their future. There's one specific example though, that I'm very proud of. The General Labor Training Program. We work with the City Department of Human Resources and the Department of Streets and Sanitation to partner with Chicago Public Schools and local 1001 to develop and implement what we call a General Labor Training Program. This 12-week on-the-job training opportunity provided 70 CPS graduating students with job skills. Participants achieved union bidder rights during the program, and upon successful completion, they were offered the opportunity to bid on placement for labor vacancies. 55 of the 70 general laborer trainees were hired full-time, and they are working for the city of Chicago today. That's here today. Takiyah Brown is here with us today. Takiyah was hired directly from the training program and is an example of how job opportunity can change the career trajectory of our city's young people. And under my leadership, Chicago has become the most pro-worker city in America. This year, we enacted the most expansive paid leave statute for a major city. The impact of this legislation will be felt by over 1 million workers, effectively doubling the amount of paid leave available. Workers now have significantly more time to spend with their families, personal health needs, and of course to care for their loved ones. Additionally, we enacted the One Fair Wage Ordinance with the support of a coalition of partners, including community advocates from the One Fair Wage Coalition and Women Employed. Together, we eliminated the subminimum wage for over 60,000 tip workers. This reform boosts the livelihoods of hundreds of thousands of Chicagoans, primarily women of color, and supports small businesses so that it encourages people to get back into the restaurant and hospitality industries. And under my leadership, we became a safer city. We invested in programs and strategies that are proven to foster safe communities, and the results speak for themselves. Since I've been in office, we have seen a decrease in homicides, shootings, robberies, vehicular hijacking, criminal sexual assaults. Look, it's a lot of work to be done, but we are moving in the right direction. I promised that during my first term that I would promote 200 new detectives to the Chicago Police Department. Well, we have achieved that, and we did it without increasing the number of sworn officers. And today I'm proud that by the end of the year, that goal will be fully realized. And promoting these brave men and women to be detectives has already begun to pay dividends. Right now, we have a homicide clearance rate of nearly 54%. And again, while we have more work to do, you all, it is the highest since 2015. So I do want to thank our Superintendent Snelling and the brave women and men of the Chicago Police Department for facilitating hard work to make sure that this city continues to make progress. I also want to recognize our Mayor's Office of Community Safety, their impressive efforts to holistically address the root causes of violence, with the common goal of keeping our city safe. In addition to keeping Chicago safe, we delivered on a long sought after promise to expand our mental health system. We are reopening a public mental health clinic in Roseland. We are layering Mental health services at Lakeville Library. It's the full force of government, you all. It's the vision for a better, stronger, safer Chicago. We have made the monumental transition, though, from a co-responder police response to a full public health response for 911 calls regarding mental health crises. Now, this work would not have been possible without the strong partnership, the leadership of my friend and ally, my sister, Alderwoman Rodriguez Sanchez. You know, this mental health system expansion ordinance, it was designed and was created with a working group and allowed us to make these new investments. But for me, this work to expand mental health access, it is personal. I often talk about my brother Leon, who is my hero. He struggled with mental illness and died addicted and unhoused. I believe that a real commitment to mental health, treating people rather than criminalizing these individuals who are experiencing trauma, that allows for lives to be extended on this earth. I'm proud of the vital work of our care team that they've done, responding to families and individuals in need. And we give them the help that they deserve. And I want to take a moment to acknowledge Tiffany Patton Burnside, the Senior Director of Crisis Services. Such an integral part of the care leadership team and a passionate advocate for her team and this program from the start. Tiffany has shepherded. So thank you, Tiffany, to your entire team. The care team has addressed over 1,500 cases and counting. Woo! Under my leadership, we supported our residents in their time of need. You know, after the West Side was hit with an intense flood, my administration through the Chicago Department of Housing, we secured an additional $5 million for Flood Assistance Repair Program. This program aims to support up to 200 homeowners whose homes were damaged significantly during the torrential rains in July of 2023. And I'm proud to say that we are still moving full steam ahead with these repairs. This week, Faye Cobbins, a proud resident of the Best Side, the West Side of Chicago, will have work done on her house. And in the past year, we have made it clear to Chicago that we are open for business. We have worked hand in hand with government agencies, the state, the county, World Business Chicago, and the business community to usher in more than $20 billion of new investments in the city of Chicago. And this includes Psi Quantum, which will anchor the Illinois Quantum and Microelectronics Park. It's that whole campus that will transform the southeast side of Chicago. That place has been left vacant for the last 30-something years. And under my administration, we finally delivered something for the southeast side of Chicago. The LaSalle Street investments that will convert four underutilized offices into mixed-use buildings and create more than 1,000 new apartments, affordable homes downtown. We broke ground in Google's new Chicago headquarters at the Thompson Center. We celebrated the one-year anniversary since the opening of the Tipperary Valley's Tipperary Casino site, which currently employs over 450 residents, and we began construction on that $1.7 billion permanent casino project. We also celebrated renovations to the J.P. Morgan Chase Building, O'Hare's global expansion, and countless other projects. These investments demonstrate the deep confidence that business has in Chicago and in my administration. This past year, we demonstrated what it means to be a global city. This summer, we showed the world why Chicago is genuinely the greatest freaking city in the world when we hosted the best Democratic National Convention, brought over $370 million to this city. Even the press said if it goes well, it won't be because of him, but if it goes bad, it will be because of him. Well, guess what? It went well. The city of Chicago made a promise to the world that he would show up to the world. historic DNC. We hosted major sporting events and countless music events and festivals, and we generated more than $800 million in the economic impact of our city. After a successful summer, I had a chance to travel to London to continue to strengthen Chicago's global presence and drive new opportunities for investments, for economic growth, and international collaboration. This trip resulted in another pro-Chicago decision being made for Perks, a company that will provide access to affordable healthcare services to workers at not-for-profits and micro-businesses. They have chosen to locate its first U.S. headquarters right here in Chicago, and in partnership with Choose Chicago, the MPEA, we've seen Chicago solidify its status as the best city in the U.S. for conventions, with 82 total meetings at the Performing Place so far this year, with more than 1 million attendees, creating numerous job opportunities and having long-lasting impact on the vitality of this city. And just last month, we hosted the International Manufacturing Technology Show, one of the largest trade shows in the world, at McCormick Place, attracting nearly 90,000 attendees. This year, we passed the Cut the Tape initiative to fast track commercial and residential development in Chicago to get more shovels in the ground so that we can get more cranes in the sky. Because for too long, we've heard that it is too difficult to build in Chicago. We have heard that the city needs to get out of its own way and reduce the hurdles that developers and contractors face when they're trying to develop housing and commercial properties. And that is why last year, I signed that executive order, requiring 14 city departments to evaluate their development process and propose solutions that will remove the bottlenecking to accelerate review and approval timelines. And we're seeing the impact of this already. Developments are moving faster and the pipeline is growing. For example, the time that it takes for a project to get to the Planning Commission is down 40%, from 131 days to 79 days. And I want to thank the broad coalition of development leaders that work with my team to contribute to this plan. The many developers, the architects, contractors, attorneys, lenders, advocates, and so many more. We kicked off this historic investment in our neighborhoods with our people and for our people when we passed the $1.25 billion housing and economic development bond, the largest economic development bond and investment for housing and economic development in the history of Chicago. This administration continues to make history for the people of this city. And this bond is a game changer for our city. $625 million. $625 million going directly into small businesses, community assets that are ultimately the anchor of the neighborhoods across the cities. We've already used this bond to invest in local businesses like the Austin Hope Center. This facility will be anchored by Lurie Children's Clinic. And the building will also be occupied by Threshold, who will provide behavioral health care to people experiencing serious mental illness, people who are experiencing homelessness and living on the streets on the west side. And by investing in spaces like the Austin Hope Center, my administration seeks to continue to close gaps currently that exist in our healthcare system, and particularly neighborhoods like Austin. The west side will never be forgotten again. Ever. In addition to investing in our business development and our commercial real estate needs, other $625 million will go towards building more affordable homes. I'm so tired of black people being kicked out of this city. The Negro Removal Act has been decades of negligence for our people. We're going to keep building and preserving and repairing homes across this city. That is what the people voted for. And that's what the people deserve, and that's what they're going to get in this budget. That's why we turned over vacant land so that developers can build affordable homes in the 20th Ward, in the 9th Ward, in the 24th Ward. And additionally, my administration utilized the once-in-a-lifetime American Rescue Plan Act, where we relaunched the city's ARPA spending plan in June of this year after careful evaluation of each initiative. And I'm proud to say that we've doubled the emergency fund for gender-based violence survivors to $10 million, providing immediate, unrestricted cash assistance for those seeking safety and stability. Thank you, Stephanie Coleman. Thank you, Jeanette Taylor. Thank you, Maria Hatton, for seeing black women. Through the expansion of the CDPH's Family Connections Program. We also are supporting artists and arts organizations in need because the pandemic wreaked havoc on the art industry and providing much needed grant assistance to small businesses and not-for-profits to help sustain their workforce and to build up their capacity post-pandemic. Every investment that we made last year, from youth employment, workforce development, mental health, community safety, housing, homelessness, demonstrates our commitment to investing in people. And I want it to be very clear. I have to be clear. In this year's budget, we are going to build on the progress that we've made. Even in a difficult budget year, we will not stop investing in our city. The people who make the city thrive, we will continue to invest in them. And over the course of the past year, my community engagement team worked to actively engage residents during this budget process. We held 4 public roundtables, one exclusively for young people across the city. We need to hear directly from people so that we can make sure that their priorities are in this budget. And we listen to the needs of the community and we use the robust community engagement process to guide us when we develop this budget, just as we did in 2024. And in this year's budget, we will continue to invest in people. We will continue to invest in communities and empower everyone to be able to live up to their greatest potential. And that is why in this investment, in this budget, a $52 million investment will again be prioritized for our young people. We're going to increase the number of paid summer jobs for our city's youth program by additional 2,000 positions, preparing our young people for the next year. And in collaboration with Alderwoman Fuentes, we will build upon the foundation set this year by expanding the number of peacekeeper positions within the One Summer Chicago, while also enhancing the My Shy, My Future website and the mobile application to incorporate the tools and resources of the Peace Book. The Peace Book program is not only about hiring our young people, but it's about enabling them to directly contribute to the safety of our city. I want to thank Alderwoman Fuentes and DFSS Commissioner Brandon Canazzi for their tireless effort, the team work that they put in to make sure that components of the Peace Book become a reality. And in fact, the 2025 budget, the work of Alderwoman Fuentes and the work of Commissioner Canazzi will make sure that the components of the Peace Book finally make it in its totality in the 2025 budget. In addition, to the One Summer Chicago, city departments will once again host student interns and trainees, create a pathway for our young people to find careers in public service. Through an investment of $40 million in this budget, we will see our capacity to care for the unhoused in the city expand by more than doubling the number of beds within the city's shelter network from 3,000 to 6,800 beds. Through our partnership with the state of Illinois, our vision for a one shelter system for anyone that needs help can find assistance will begin to take shape. With an investment of $30 million, we will continue to move households from temporary homeless shelters or unsheltered locations into stable housing through the city's rapid rehousing program and accelerating our moving events. Please say this other note about this one shelter system. When our city was under attack by the governor of Texas, intentionally targeting our city, this city rose above the pettiness of nasty politics. Not only did we show up for new arrivals, we created a system that will benefit all of Chicago. When 70% of Chicagoans who are unhoused are black, We need to ensure that we create systems of care to respond to the people who need the help the most. Despite what Buddy did at the border, it did not stop us from moving forward. That's the strength of this city. That's the power of a welcoming city. That's the power of an administration that understands that we are not going to allow people to separate and to divide us. We're going to come out stronger, and we have, with a single shelter system that works for everyone. We have to promote conditions for making housing more affordable, and we need new financing tools to meet the scale of the problem. And in 2025, my administration is committed to the launch of the Green Social Housing, an innovative and proven form of affordable mixed-income housing development that does not rely on federal subsidies. Not only does this model offer a way to grow the pie, it increases the number of affordable homes that the city can create without relying upon state and federal subsidies, and because it is structured like a revolving loan program, by recycling people every few years, it allows for new projects to go online. This program will be funded with $135 million from the Housing and Economic Development Bond, making it the largest social housing revolving loan fund in the entire country. Chicago, we're doing it again. Sustainable rental units for Chicagoans. We can do it over the next 5 years. Additionally, in the years ahead, we will continue to advance the once-in-a-generation modernization project known as O'Hare 21, starting with the construction of Satellite Concourse 1. The 19-gate expansion is already underway. This will create over 3,800 construction jobs and numerous contracting opportunities for diverse firms of all sizes. This administration will continue to work to strengthen the mental health network of those in this city. And by building upon reopening the 3 mental health clinics in 2025, we will continue to build capacity with those clinics, as well as hiring behavioral health telecommunicators within our Office of Emergency Management and Communications to ensure that calls are triaged appropriately with care dedicated to those who are in need. With over $100 million in investments in community violence prevention in 2025, we will continue our work, you all, to provide direct investments to communities that are being plagued by violence. The Mayor's Office of Community Safety awarded several key community organizations with grants that are ultimately leading efforts to decrease violence and increase investments in the areas of these sections of the city that need it the most. And Teamwork Inglewood will lead our efforts in Inglewood. The historic Westside NAACP will lead the efforts in Austin, and Beyond the Ball in Little Village will work hand in hand with my administration to make place-based and people-based investments through the People's Plan for Community. In addition, under the direction of our new Director of Reentry, Joseph Mapp, the Office of Reentry will lead this administration's effort to reintegrate those who are returning home from incarceration so that they can experience support and they can actually have some dignity. We'll see over $5 million awarded to community-based organizations who are on the front line doing this work. And this year, we saw the reestablishment of the city's Department of the Environment. We cannot afford to have cuts to key areas of our government that will put our planet in jeopardy. And despite the spending the bulk of this year staffing up the department under the leadership of our Chief Sustainability Officer, Angela Tovar. She is championing so much. That's right, give it up for Angela Tovar. So beginning in January, the city will celebrate a major milestone by transitioning its operations to 100% renewable electricity, thanks to a contract with Constellation Energy to power all city-owned buildings, streetlights, Midway and O'Hare airports, Jardine, and all the other 400-plus city facilities. And we are not resting just simply on these achievements alone. Today, I'm happy to announce that through the partnership with the Civic Consulting Alliance, in 2025, we will further deliver on our plan to reconstitute the Department of the Environment through the delivery of a transition plan, laying out the steps to shift from more regulatory authority under the Chief Sustainability Officer so that we can take on our full responsibility to combat global climate change while healing the communities that have been burdened by environmental justice. 20% of the world's fresh water is in our front yard. Global population shift will continue to happen, whether it's through policies or whether it's through climate change. The city of Chicago can hold another million people in it. We gotta return people who have been forced out, and we gotta make sure we open our arms for those who will seek refuge here. And I mean, we are a global city with world-class attractions and festivals attended by people from around the world. You know, the budget invests $3 million additional funding dollars to enhance the cultural special events hosted by our Department of Cultural Affairs and Special Events, with an increase of $1 million to our arts grants program and DCASE's operational budget. Over $9 million in funding will go towards supporting artists and cultural organizations to foster creative initiatives and to contribute to the artistic and cultural vitality this city is known for, you all. We have accomplished so much this year. The investments that we've made are a down payment of implementing the values I was elected to uphold. And because we cannot talk about making lasting change in our city without investing in young people, we can't talk about long transformational change in our city without talking about housing and mental health and community safety. These are the investments that will change this city. When I ran for mayor, I said the city's fiscal position was much worse than what was being forecast. And within months of taking office, our budget team, led by Annette Guzman, issued a revised forecast that, in fact, predicted that we would face a budget gap close to more than $1 billion, or at least $1 billion. And we are facing that challenge head on. We will continue to invest in our priorities so that we can build the future that we all want for a better, stronger, safer Chicago. We will not neglect our long-term obligations. We will pay our debt and our pension. And we will continue to embrace business and economic development, but we have to work with less resources right now. But we really have to raise more revenue. Let me pause for a moment to be very clear. I stand here today before you with the absolute willingness to invest in Chicago and the willingness to make hard decisions so that we can be fiscally responsible to balance a budget. And we can do that. We can hold the truth of investment and being responsible. They can exist. Meeting our obligations today so that we have the resources for the future, so that we can continue to invest in our people, that's the smart approach. The city has, for far too many administrations, have governed with this veneer of fiscal responsibility, when in fact they weren't. This is not our path today. When we released our budget forecast this year, we were faced with one of the largest budget gaps in the city. Anticipating the depth of our fiscal challenge, our financial team began working on ways to lower the cost through budgetary efficiencies while also identifying ways to increase our revenue. And therefore, we made very smart, timely adjustments to our expenditures. My budget team asked every department to cut their budget by 3%. Not only did our departments meet that challenge, but many of them went beyond. Because they understand that for Chicago, we can provide a more efficient government while still meeting the needs of our residents. And City Council, you all also stepped up, thank you, cutting your budgets by 3%, and of course, the mayor's office. We have partners with our city clerk, city treasurer. We also cut vacancies where they weren't mission critical. What does cutting vacancies mean to Chicagoans? It means that positions that are empty today because someone retired or moved to a different job will not be filled. It means that jobs we have planned to fill will be eliminated. It means that the city's workforce will have to operate more effectively. We will have to have more lean services. large organization has waste, the city of Chicago is no exception. Our departments drill down to determine where there's waste or overlap. We ask ourselves, what can be done in a better way? For these measures alone, we save $300 million. To put that into perspective, those savings of their own represent an amount larger than the general fund budget of the entire city of Rockville. And these savings are on top of the $200 million already achieved in the 2024 budget through very prudent fiscal practices that were implemented by my budget team. And while some have called for extreme austerity measures, such as mass layoffs to address our fiscal gap, these are not solutions that align with our values. As a city, it is our responsibility to provide services to our residents, the business community, and to countless visitors who come here. Mass layoffs would hamper our ability to drive economic development and protect our most vulnerable. People who provide and rely upon healthcare. I want to take a moment to spell out to everyone what Chicago would look like if we only used cuts to our city's workforce to solve the budget gap. We would need to reduce our workforce by another 4,000 positions, equating to a 17% reduction in the city's workforce. We would have to reduce our police force by 2,500 personnel, or just under 20%. We would be forced to reduce our fire department by over 600 personnel, dramatically lowering our ability to respond to fires and provide life-saving medical care. Our streets would see garbage collection and recycling and rat abatement services and tree trimming completely limited and less frequent, as our sanitation department will be reduced by 150 additional positions, and the maintenance and repair of our physical assets would be further hampered as our facilities team would see an over 200 personnel cut. These cuts threaten to make our neighborhoods, our residents, and our workers less safe. I want to be clear, we will not have layoffs in this budget, and we will still raise more revenue to ensure that we can keep up with our investment.
Yeah, yeah.
So here's what we did. We took a good look at our TIF funds. My administration has spent last year examining every TIF district and worked with our departments to remove projects that are no longer viable while still reserving funding for projects that will benefit our overall city. In doing so, we've been able to ensure that every single dollar not used for projects will be returned to all of the taxing bodies throughout the entire county. Here's what this exercise allows for us to do. Our TIF surplus will be $507 million, with $131 million being surplus to the city, over $300 million surplus to Chicago Public Schools, record amounts to other taxing bodies, including the Park District, City Colleges, Chicago Public Libraries, Cook County, and Metropolitan Water Reclamation District. Here's why that's important for our community colleges. Since I've been in office, 12% increase in enrollment in our city colleges. The number one subgroup of individuals who are enrolling in our city colleges are young black men. So the billions of dollars of investments that are coming, we're creating the workforce that can benefit from those investments. In total, this budget includes over $400 million in additional revenue, including enhancements to our existing revenue streams. And through the leadership of the city's corporation council, we are cracking down on these bad actors and corporations that owe the city money, pursuing another $30 million to the efforts of our law department. In terms of revenue enhancements, my administration worked diligently to find these inefficient areas in our tax and licensing rates that will raise revenue for the city without overburdening Chicagoans, such as removing the retail concession portion of a bag tax to ensure that the full 7 cents goes towards the city revenue. In other words, your mayor is making sure we get all of our money. And here's what I said from the start. I'm committed to protecting security, the retirement security, and upholding our pension obligations. In this budget, we are adhering to our policy to make a contribution that ensures our unfunded liabilities will not grow further. This fiscally prudent policy is projected to save the city almost $3 billion in future pension contributions so that we can ensure that our children are not saddled with these long deferred costs, and our workers can be confident that pensions that they spent their careers earning will be there at retirement. Our city workers have their pension contributions deducted from every paycheck, and they never miss or defer deposit in essence. We must uphold our obligation as well. And then when we invest in our retirees and our workers, it keeps our communities vibrant and alive. In Austin, the neighborhood where my wife and I are raising our family, the local economy would collapse if we did not have pensioners holding up our zip code. And that is why, to ensure that we don't let people up, to ensure that we hold our obligation, to make sure that we continue to make sure that we invest in housing and employment, and mental health, and safety. That is why this budget currently includes a property tax increase of $300 million to fund and keep our commitment to fund not just our pension contributions, but to fund the future of our city. This is tough. It is. It is something that I grappled with for weeks and weeks. We didn't make this decision lightly. I directed my budget team to look at all the options at closing this budget gap. And when it came down to either mass layoffs, curbing vital city services, or an increase in property taxes, I would certainly much rather tax the rich. But I did have to make the choice to increase our property. And I understand that today I'm asking families to lean in yet again, do a little bit more in order to make sure that their neighbors are not laid off, and to make sure that we don't have to cut vital city services. I know that across the city, working families make tough decisions every day. God knows that I do. And whether it's the cost of childcare or paying utilities, certainly I know the challenge of paying utilities. And even going grocery shopping and buying food for our families, I know adding to those tough choices is not easy. This was the best option that I had at this time. It allows us to move forward in a sustainable way. This is the start of a multi-year process that will finally get Chicago's finances back on track. It is important to realize that one of the reasons why we have made some of these decisions is because our ability to raise revenue that we ultimately need to fund the essential mission of city government, it is limited. City of Chicago cannot do this alone. The largest revenue sources are either controlled or limited at the state level, whether it's personal income tax or corporate income tax, sales tax policy. These are controlled by the state. We need to continue to work with the state and the county in a truly collaborative manner to make our revenue streams more equitable. And I have no doubt that with the strong partnership of the state and the county, that we can do that together. Our North Star is to make the city's taxes more equitable. This goal is shared by many, if not most of the people in this room, as well as the majority of city residents. Now, we are not the first to take up this fight. When Governor Pritzker led the good and just effort to create a graduated income tax in Illinois, the federal government and most states have graduated income tax because it is the more fair and equitable method. Higher income earners who have more ability to pay should do and pay more, and lower income earners should have to pay less. It's very simple. The city of Chicago voters, we said yes to that. Our black and brown residents resoundingly voted in the affirmative for that graduated income tax. But unfortunately, a handful of ultra-rich corporate interests lobbied against the referendum and it was defeated. This year, Chicago residents voted on Bring Chicago Home, which would have provided much needed funds to support programming and operations to reduce homelessness in the city. The referendum would have authorized an increase to the transfer tax with properties over $1 million when they're being sold. The referendum even included an inflator so that the $1 million threshold would grow over time, because we did not want the homes of just average working people in Chicago to eventually be subject to the tax just because of inflation. And once again, the efforts of the interests of ultra-rich and corporations funded a smear campaign which sowed fear and misunderstanding to the electorate If that referendum had passed, the city would have collected an average of $100 million more in revenues to fund the critical needs of our unhoused residents. Do you know that the number of beds that we actually need to really transform our single shelter system, the number of beds that we need, the amount that prevented us from meeting that number was the exact amount of money we would have raised to Bring Chicago. Lastly, we did discuss extensively the 2025 budget forecast, Chicago's revenues from the personal property revenue tax dropped precipitously this year due to the expiration in the state law that now allows for corporations to claim unlimited losses against their positive income gains, resulting in a decline of over $150 million since 2020. So yet again, the interests of corporations continue to get favored over working people. And this budget proposal reflects the reality of our fiscal constraints. We will continue, of course, though, the work with our partners, all of our labor partners, business partners, city council members, and other stakeholders to tackle this challenge and to make sure that we have distributed taxes so that the burden is not on working people. And we can make sure that the entities that can do more, that they pay their fair share. So I welcome additional revenue ideas that allow us to make our obligations and make critical investments and to protect our residents. My administration takes seriously our duty to make sure our revenue collection is equitable and balanced as possible. And that is why we passed an ordinance to greatly expand debt relief programs. This year, we permanently codified the city's Clear Path Relief Program and Administrative Debt Relief Program to ensure pathway for relief from fee and fine debt for those individuals who are least able to shoulder it. It is why under my administration, we have expanded the utility billing relief program to free flats to further live out the goals of the program and provide much needed relief to qualified homeowners. And that is why through our partnership with Alderman Espada, Alderman Villegas, we will be implementing the water leak relief pilot program to provide substantial financial relief to residents facing unexpected water bills due to these negligible underground water leaks. And we aren't stopping there. Next year, we will be instituting another parking ticket amnesty program, the 2025 amnesty, which my administration worked on with Chairwoman Dow and Vice Mayor Burnett to develop, will allow residents to get clean of their city parking debt penalties while repaying the principal that they owe. With this proposed budget, we are balanced, but we're not just balanced. We are focused on delivering to the people of Chicago. We are making sure that we are providing working people of the city with support, services, and opportunities that they need and that they deserve. We are building a government that truly works for the people. Because no longer will Chicago turn its back on those who are struggling with mental health issues. Instead, the city will lend a helping hand to them. No longer will the city of Chicago be dismissive about our young people and the children who are the future of the city. Instead, we are going to give them real jobs with a W-2 so that they can see opportunity and achieve success. No longer will Chicago's neighborhoods be forgotten. We are going to make sure that residents are not only safe, that crime is ultimately solved. We are going to make sure that our neighborhoods flourish with more and more investments. No longer can Chicago, and no longer will Chicago, be a city where folks cannot afford a home. We are going to build, we are going to build, we are going to build and make sure that there is affordable housing for every single family who needs it. No more disinvestment, no more selling off our public assets. I am saying no to those bad habits and yes to the future of this city. Taking ownership of years of poor decisions that have left everyday Chicagoans behind and charting a new pathway forward that actually invests in our people. We are holding our promise to the people of Chicago to move forward, to move together, to move forward with a brighter future. The potential for Chicago Chicago is still endless, and I'm proud to stand before you today and say that we are not slowing down. We will not be complacent. We will not turn our backs on the people of the greatest freaking city in the world. There is only one direction we're going, and that is full steam ahead. We've already changed the course of this city. This budget was made possible by the countless city workers and leaders and residents who informed this budget, guided us through these very difficult decisions, and supported this mission to invest in people. I want to thank our city department leaders, our commissioners, steadfastly served our city. It greatly informed our budget process. I also want to thank this finance team. Annette Guzman is a bad lad, such a bottom of my heart. God bless you all. God bless the city. Thank you.